Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon so that you never miss any video lesson from Rao's IAS Study Circle.
Hello and welcome to Daily News Simplified, an analysis of the Hindi newspaper from UPSC perspective.
Today we will discuss the Delhi edition of the Hindi newspaper dated 13th January 2022. And the articles that we will discuss today are displayed on your screen. So let us start the discussion. Now in our weekly series of mains answer writing practice from the Daily News Simplified videos, today's question for answer writing is, do you think the poverty line in India is able to capture the real poverty scenario? Give arguments in support of your answer. The question is for 250 words and 15 marks. You can post your answer in the comment section below in the form of screenshots or in the PDF format. And you will get these answers evaluated if you post your answers before Saturday. This article on page number 6 is related to the issue of hate speech. And this was in news because of an event that was held at Haridwar, and this is presently under the consideration of Supreme Court of India. In this regard, the author here highlights that there is an absence of legal as well as social consensus in India regarding or against the hate speech. In this background, let us try and understand what exactly is the impact of hate speech, what has been the history of hate speech, and how hate speech leads to violence in societies. In this regard, we'll also try to understand what are the issues in India regarding the approach that is used to tackle the hate speech. And finally, we'll look at what needs to be done in this regard. Now, the points that we will discuss here are important for us from General Studies Paper 2 point of view in the topic Constitution, Polity and Governance. Now, in the DNS of 28 December 2021, we have discussed various issues associated with the lack of definition of hate speech in India and what exactly are the laws related to hate speech. In that discussion, we have also discussed about some recommendations provided by the Law Commission for tackling the hate speech. However, in this article, we will try to understand the larger impact of the hate speech and also what needs to be done in order to create a societal consensus against the hate speech. Now, the issue here is that in the Indian Constitution, we have been provided with a fundamental right by the name freedom of speech and expression under Article 19. Now, this right has been provided to the Indian citizens under the Indian Constitution as a guarantee, and it also limits the power of the state against undue interference in the exercise of this right of freedom of speech and expression. However, some reasonable restrictions have been imposed on the freedom of speech and expression. Now, these reasonable restrictions that have been imposed under Article 19 on the freedom of speech and expression are limited to the security of the state, sovereignty and integrity of India, friendly relations with foreign states, public order, decency, morality, etc. However, it does not take into account the issue of hate speech. And that is why this issue of hate speech has come into news regularly, because the Constitution does not clearly define what exactly constitutes as a hate speech. So it is not just the Constitution, but also the other Indian laws do not define clearly what exactly constitutes the hate speech. And that exactly is at the base of this controversy. In this regard, we first need to understand what exactly is the impact of the hate speech. Now, hate speech is normally directed against a community or a person, especially with the aim of inciting violence against that person or against a particular community in this society. In this regard, the harm that is caused by the hate speech is not just the direct calls for violence, but hate speech creates a climate that strengthens existing prejudices and entrenches the already existing discrimination in the society. Now, the issue here is that we are a diverse society. And in this society, various castes exist. In this, we have different religions. And also, various linguistic groups are part of India. And in the context of such diversity, the hate speech can create a climate which can strengthen the existing prejudices and can also increase or entrench deeply into the minds of the population the already existing discrimination. In this regard, if hate speech is used as a tool by the majority communities against minority communities, it can create an atmosphere and increase the existing discrimination against the minorities in India. And that exactly is the issue with the hate speech, because it creates a climate that strengthens the existing prejudices and entrenches the already existing discrimination. Now, if you go through the NCERT of class 6 of the social studies, it has beautifully explained the issue of diversity and the discrimination that exists in our society and what exactly is meant by prejudices and the stereotypes that are governed in the society and that ultimately leads to discrimination. So firstly, this chapter of the NCERT beautifully explains that we are a diverse society and there are differences in the society in the terms of number of religions that exist in our society, the number of languages that exist in our society. That is, around 1600 languages are spoken in India and there are 8 major religions. So these are some of the differences that exist in the society. However, these differences are not an issue at the face of it. But this becomes an issue when a particular religion is stereotyped and is looked at from a prejudiced point of view. In this regard, prejudice simply means to judge other people negatively or see them as inferior. And when we think that only one particular way is the best and the right way to do things, we often end up not respecting others who may prefer to do things differently. So let us look at the example that has been taken by the NCERT in this regard. It takes the example that if somebody thinks that English is the best language and other languages are not important, that means that that particular person is judging the other languages negatively. And that exactly is meant by prejudice. And in a similar manner, we can be prejudiced about many things, which can include people's religions, beliefs, the color of the skin, and the region from which they come. Also, it can be based on the language that they speak, the accent that they speak, or the clothes that they wear, and such prejudices can also be based on genders. Then another issue at the base of hate speech is the stereotyping of a particular group and particular people. Now, such stereotyping can be based on religion, country, sex, race, economic background, etc. And in this regard, it is said that we sometimes fix people into one image, and that is how we create a stereotype. So when people say that those who belong to particular country, religion, sex, race, economic background, and if they say that such people are lazy, criminal or dumb, these people are using stereotypes against a particular group of people. Now the issue with the stereotypes is that it stops us from looking at each person as unique individual with his or her own special qualities and skills. And these qualities and skills can sometimes be different from what you perceive as qualities or skills. And that is what is at the base of discrimination in the society. That is, both the prejudices and the stereotypes are at the base of the society. And especially these prejudices and stereotypes are sometimes used in hate speeches to incite violence against particular group of community, etc. And exactly in this regard, the NCERT says that discrimination happens when people act on their prejudices and stereotypes. So that is why the hate speech is one of the manifestations of these prejudices and the stereotypes that exist in our society. Now, hate speech is not a new thing in our society, and it has existed in the society since long time. However, the manifestation of hate speech, which has been seen in the history, makes us believe that hate speech can be detrimental to the harmony that exists in our society. Now, if you look at the Europe between First and the Second World War, we all are aware that the Nazi Germany led to the Holocaust against the Jewish population. In this regard, the author analyzes that what started as daily calls for discrimination against the Jewish community finally manifested itself in the form of Holocaust during the Second World War. And that exactly makes us believe that hate speech can be detrimental in the long term because it creates discrimination against a particular community and it is sometimes normalized in the society. So the author says that the Holocaust in the European Germany happened largely because the discrimination against the Jews was normalized in the society. So the author says that the Holocaust could finally happen primarily because of the discrimination against the Jews was normalized in the European society. And this normalization of discrimination against the Jews in the society took place based on stereotypes, social prejudice, justified discrimination, and social as well as economic boycott of the Jewish community. Another example of hate speech manifesting itself into violence is the Rwandan genocide. In this, a hate radio had started in Rwanda in 1990s. And anti-Tutsi community articles and graphic cartoons began appearing in the newspapers from around 1990s. In June 1993, a radio was started in Rwanda that was known as Radio Television Libre des Mille Collines. And this Rwandan radio reinforced the existing prejudices and stereotypes in the society against the Tutsi community, which led to the Rwandan genocide. So both these examples of the Jewish Holocaust during the Second World War and also the Rwandan genocide make us believe that hate speech is a grave problem for harmony in the society. And that is why the tackling of hate speech becomes very important in the Indian society as well, because we are seeing examples of hate speech time and again. However, the Indian laws as well as the society does not recognize properly or define the hate speech properly. Now, since the impact of the hate speech is so grave, most societies across the globe define hate speech in terms of both inciting violence as well as inciting discrimination. Normally in Indian society, what is happening right now is that if a call is given for inciting violence, only then it is considered as hate speech. However, the other societies in the world are also defining the hate speech in terms of those speeches that incite discrimination or those speeches that reinforce the existing prejudices and the stereotypes in the society and which ultimately lead to discrimination against a particular group or community in the society. And that is why a broad definition of the hate speech is required, because it primarily sets the stage for future violence, and it is also weaponized by some communities to entrench and endorse inequality and subordination against the other communities. In this regard, let us try and understand what are the issues in India's approach to tackle the hate speech. Now, in this regard, the author says that the Indian laws are unequipped to deal with the challenges of the hate speech. And the laws that are commonly invoked against hate speeches are first, Section 295A of the Indian Penal Code and the Section 153A of the Indian Penal Code. The Section 295A is related to blasphemy, and the Section 153A is related to creating enmity between the classes of people. And this clearly shows that the Indian laws do not take into account those hate speeches that are entrenching or inciting discrimination against one group or particular group in Indian society. And that is why the author says that the Indian laws are presently unequipped to deal with the challenges of the hate speech. You can always go through the DNS of 28 December 2021, where we have discussed the issues with the Indian laws in tackling the issue of hate speech in India. Further, the author analyzes that the hate speech is that speech that targets people based on their identity and calls for violence or discrimination against people because of their identity. And at times during the hate speeches, euphemism is used to not take the name of a community directly. And that is what protects the person who is delivering the hate speech, because sometimes euphemism is used and the hate speeches do not take the name of a community directly. Rather, the hate speeches are worded with ambiguity and they are defended as calls for self-defense rather than calls for violence. In this regard, majority communities say that they are doing so in order to protect themselves. They are not doing so in order to discriminate against the other societies or other groups in the society. And this is what has been called as indirect hate speech. And indirect hate speech is sometimes known as dog whistle or dog whistling. Now, what happens in indirect hate speech or dog whistling is that it escapes the attention of an external observer. However, both the speaker of the hate speech as well as the listener of the hate speech knows what and who is being referred to in that particular hate speech. And that is what has been termed as dog whistling. So that is how we see that the Indian laws are not equipped to tackle all these issues associated with the hate speech, and that is why a broader definition of the hate speech is required. So in this context, it has been highlighted that on the one hand, we need to strengthen our laws and define hate speech in a broader manner to create social harmony, and so that the history is not repeated in the form of Holocaust that took place in Europe or the Rwandan genocide. However, what is required is a social consensus. And in this regard, the author says that a social consensus is required about what kind of speech is unacceptable in the society. For example, in Europe, the Holocaust denial is an offense, and it reflects a kind of social consensus that has been created in the Europe because of the history of Holocaust that took place during the Second World War. In this regard, a social consensus becomes important because it distinguishes cases of hate speech from other forms of confrontational as well as agitational speech. And finally, the author says that achieving this social consensus will require both consistent legal implementation over a period of time, and also daily conversations as a society are needed amongst ourselves, especially amongst the socially privileged classes or privileged sections of the society, because it becomes a responsibility of the socially privileged classes to take care of the underprivileged classes in the overall societal dynamics. So this is all about hate speech, where we have seen that the prejudices and the stereotypes are utilized by the hate speech in order to increase discrimination in the society. In this regard, the Indian laws are not equipped to tackle those hate speeches that increase or create discrimination in the Indian society. And that is why the author has analyzed that there's a need for social consensus in order to tackle the issue of hate speech in India. With this, let's take up the next news article now. Now, this article on page number 6 has been written in the context of the issues associated with the independence of the Office of the Election Commission in India. In this regard, recently an event happened where the Chief Election Commissioner and his Election Commissioner colleagues attended an informal meeting with the Principal Secretary to the Prime Minister. And this has started the debate regarding the independence of the Office of Election Commission in India. Now, ECI, as we all are aware, is important for democratic transfer of political power, and it has been the primary role of the Election Commission since the independence, and that is what has made India a functional democracy. Now, in the recent times, various issues and controversies have started regarding the functioning of the Election Commission in India, especially in a manner that has been seen as partisan. In this regard, there have been issues regarding the announcement of the election dates to benefit the ruling party, money and the muscle role in election, and that is why it becomes important for us to analyze the existing issues, both legal, constitutional as well as functional, in the functioning of the Election Commission of India. And all the points that we discuss here are important for us from General Studies paper 2 point of view in the topic Constitution and Polity. So let us look at what are the articles in the Indian Constitution related to the Election Commission of India, and what are some of the issues related to the Office of Election Commission. Now, the Article 324 in the Indian Constitution provides that the superintendence, direction and control of the elections will be vested in an election commission. And the superintendence, direction and the control of the preparation of electoral rolls for and conduct of all the elections to the parliament, elections to the legislature of every state, elections to the offices of president and vice president held under this constitution shall be vested in a commission that has been referred to as the Election Commission in this particular article. Now, you might be aware that the state election commissions are appointed on a state level to conduct the Panchayati Raj elections. So this is the role of the Election Commission that has been provided for in the Indian Constitution, that is superintendence, direction and control of the preparation of electoral rolls and the conduct of all the elections relating to parliament, the state legislatures, the election to the office of president, vice president, etc. Further, regarding the composition of the Election Commission, the Article 324(2) provides that the Election Commission shall consist of Chief Election Commissioner and such a number of other election commissioners, if any, as the President may from time to time fix, and the appointment of the Chief Election Commissioner and the other election commissioners shall be subject to the provisions of any law made on that behalf by the Parliament be made by the President. So this is the provision related to appointment of the Election Commissioner of India, that is the President of India will appoint the Election Commissioner and will also decide from time to time and fix the appointment of the Chief Election Commissioner and the other election commissioners. Now, despite the constitutional provisions that have been provided for in the Indian Constitution, especially in the Article 324, there are certain issues that have been seen in the functioning of the Election Commission and that have been at the base of the issue related to the independence of the Election Commission in India. So let us look at these issues briefly now. Now, the first and the foremost issue associated with the Election Commission is related to the appointment of the election commissioners in India. In this regard, the election commissioners, including the Chief Election Commissioner in India, is appointed by the President on the recommendations of the Prime Minister. Now, if we look at the role of the Election Commission in India, it does not serve the purpose of conducting free and fair elections only. But it also acts as a quasi-judicial body at times between the various political parties, including the ruling government and the other parties. And in such a scenario, the executive cannot be the sole participant in the appointment of the members of the Election Commission of India. And given the wide role of the Election Commission of India in ensuring free and fair election, the executive should not be solely responsible for appointment of the members of the Election Commission. This is primarily because it gives unfettered discretion to the ruling party to choose someone whose loyalty is ensured and which would render the selection process vulnerable to manipulation. And that is why a broad-based process needs to be outlined for the process of appointment of the election commissioners in India. And that is why a broad-based system should be created or outlined for the appointment of the election commissioners in India. And it should not be the sole responsibility of the executive, because such a process is vulnerable to manipulation by the ruling party in terms of appointing loyal members to the post of election commissioners in India. Second issue associated with the election commission is that the election commissioners do not get the same protection as the chief election commissioner of India. In this regard, the Article 324(5) of the Constitution protects only the chief election commissioner from the removal in a manner similar to the process of removal of the judge of Supreme Court. However, the other election commissioners can be removed by the government on the recommendations of the chief election commissioner. And that is what provides independence to the office of chief election commissioner only, and not to the office of election commissioners that are appointed in the Election Commission of India. Third issue associated with the election commission is that there is lack of legal enactment that has been provided for under the Article 324. So as we have seen that in the Article 334, it has been provided that the process of appointment of the election commissioners by the president is subject to any law passed by the parliament. That is, the appointment of the chief election commissioner and the other election commissioners according to Article 324 shall be done as per the law made by parliament in this regard. However, no such law has been made till now, and it leaves a gap and leaves the appointment of such a crucial post solely to the executives. So first issue is associated with the appointments of the election commissioners, because they are appointed by the president, or you can say they are appointed by the executives. Second issue is that the other election commissioners besides the chief election commissioner do not get the same level of protection. This is primarily because the chief election commissioner can only be removed on grounds and manner similar to the grounds and manner in which a judge of the Supreme Court is removed. However, the other election commissioners can be removed by the government on the basis of recommendations of the chief election commissioner. And finally, the provisions of the Article 324, which provides that the appointment should be done as per the law made by parliament. However, no law has been passed by the parliament in this regard. And that is what makes the position of the election commission in India vulnerable to manipulation. Now, besides the issue of independence of the Office of Election Commission, there are other issues as well. The first is that the Constitution has not prescribed any qualification for the members of the Election Commissioner. That is, it has not provided any legal, educational, administrative or judicial qualification for any person to be appointed as a member of the Election Commission. Also, the Constitution does not debar the retiring election commissioner from any further appointment by the government. And also, there is no clarity regarding the power division between the chief election commissioner and the other election commissioners. And the lack of these proper constitutional provisions also make the office of election commission vulnerable to manipulation, because the favorable postings can be provided to people who are retiring from the election commission into other government appointments. And you might be aware that the members of the UPSC as well as the CAG are debarred from any further appointment by the government. Another issue with the functioning of the Election Commission is that the Representation of People Act empowers the central government to make rules after consultation with the Election Commission of India. However, the central government is not bound to accept these laws. And that is why it has impact on various reforms that are suggested from time to time. That is because the government has to accept it, and only then can those rules be implemented. And Election Commission of India merely acts as an advisory body in this regard. And that is why election reforms are slowly being unfolded in the Indian democracy. And that is what has made or raised questions on the process of election in India. And that is why some suggestions have been forwarded from time to time. That is, Election Commission should be given the power to make rules under the electoral law instead of the central government. And it is also suggested that the process of appointment of the Election Commissioners of India should be made broad-based, and the present process of appointment of the Election Commissioners by the President and the Executive should be changed in order to make the Office of Election Commission independent or truly independent on the lines of CAG or the members of the UPSC, etc. With this, let's take up the next news article now. This article on page number 7 talks about reaping India's demographic dividend. In this line, you might all be aware that India is going through a phase where the proportion of young population in the overall demographic population of India is very high. And that is what makes the number of participants in the working age population very high in India. And that is why this article talks about reaping India's demographic dividend. That is the young working age population, which can be made to work for improving India's economic conditions as well as improving the overall demographic capital, is the need of the hour. However, there are various issues and concerns associated with the way in which the Indian demography is marching. In this regard, let us look at what exactly is required for reaping this demographic dividend, that is the young working age population that India has. And the points that we discuss here can be important for us from General Studies Paper 2 point of view in the topic social issues or social justice. Now, to understand the demographic dividend, let us first understand the theory of demographic transition. Every country passes through various stages of demographic dividend, that is stage 1, stage 2 or stage 3. In the stage 1, the population is marked by high birth rate as well as high death rate. And because of this, the population is almost stable in such countries. Now, after a point of time when the death rate increases, however, when the birth rate is still high, this leads to a natural increase in the population. And this is the expanding stage of the population of a country. And this particular phase, when the population is naturally increasing in a country, is termed as demographic dividend stage of a country. And this stage is termed as the demographic window of opportunity, when the growth in the working age population is greater than the growth in the total population. And this bulge or this increase in the working age population in a country is referred to as demographic dividend. Now, when there is growing share of working age population, it brings with it certain benefits in a country or a country's economy. Now, when the share of the working age population increases, it brings with it certain benefits for the economy or country as a whole. This is because it increases the labor supply because of number of participants or increased number of participants in the working age population. It also leads to increased savings because the number of people who are participating in the economy are more and they are leading to larger economic growth of the country. And finally, if this particular group of population, which is young, is provided with necessary skills, education and health services, it can act as human capital for the country's future growth story. Now, although it is said that India is passing through a phase of demographic transition where India can reap the benefits of demographic dividends, but there are certain issues that Indian demography faces and they need to be resolved first in order to reap the demographic dividend benefits. And first and foremost in this regard is the necessity of increasing the nutritional status of the Indian population. This is because around 60 million children in India, which is about half of all the children in India, are underweight, and about 45% are stunted, while 21% are wasted and 75% are anemic. And that is why malnutrition has been a major contributor to under 5 mortality rate in India. That is why the authors have highlighted that there is urgent need to improve the nutritional outcomes of the Indian population, especially the children. Second factor that needs to be looked into is the health of the Indian population. In this regard, the health spending by the government of India has remained very low, and the public spending on the health has remained at around 1% of the GDP of Indian economy. And that is why it has been highlighted sometimes that it is important to draft policies which promote health during this phase of demographic transition, where India can reap the benefits of demographic dividend. Third important thing here is improving the educational status of the Indian young population. In this regard, there are various reports which have highlighted the poor state of foundational literacy and numeracy in India. Also, there are various gender differences in terms of literacy, and according to the census of 2011, the literacy rate of the males have been around 84%, whereas the literacy rate for females is around 65% only. This highlights the large gap between the genders in terms of education and the literacy status. So, in order to reap the benefits of the demographic dividend, India needs to improve the quality of education at the foundation level, that is at the primary level, and also there is a need to narrow the gap in the education and the literacy status of male as well as female, because this is because if the participation of the females in the labor force is low, it will not be very beneficial for India in terms of the demographic dividend and the huge female population that India has. Another major gap that exists in India is related to skill development as well as reskilling of the labor force of India. Now, if we look at the present status of skill development, there is massive skill gap in India, where 65 to 75% of the 15 million youngsters who are entering the workforce every year are found to be unemployable or are still not ready for jobs. And this is happening at a stage when the technology is fast moving, as well as the conventional methods of employment are now changing drastically because of artificial intelligence and the new technologies that are now entering the market. And that is why there's a need for skilling on the one hand, and also there's a need for reskilling from the conventional methods of employment into the new kinds of employment that are being created because of artificial intelligence and the fourth industrial revolution in this regard. Further, there is a need for increasing the female labor force participation, and there should be provision of education, access to institutional credit, equal ownership of property, and safe working conditions are necessary to reap the benefits of demographic dividend. So these are some of the gaps in India in terms of reaping the demographic dividends in terms of health, education, and skill development. On the health level, there is a need for improving the nutritional status, and also there is a need for increased spending on the health as a percentage of GDP of India. Then there is also need for improvement in the educational status in terms of quality as well as coverage of education and literacy in the female population. And lastly, there is a need for skilling as well as reskilling in the context of changing technological advances. Plus, there is a need to focus more on increasing the female labor force participation. So these are some of the issues that India needs to tackle in order to reap the true benefits of the demographic dividend that India has presently. This editorial on page number 6 is related to the recent decision of the Competition Commission of India to launch antitrust probe against Google based on a complaint that has been filed by the Digital News Publishers Association. In this regard, no decision has been taken as of now by the Competition Commission of India, but a probe has been started. That is why it is a news in transition. But let us briefly understand what exactly is the issue here. In this regard, the Digital News Publishers Association or the DNPA has argued that the Google company has misused its market dominance and has forced unfair terms on the digital news publishers. In this regard, let us look at how the Google's dominance affects the digital news publishers here. Now, we all are aware that the Google is the dominant search engine platform across the globe. And since Google is a dominant search engine, it chooses which news websites to display. Further, around 50% of the traffic on the websites of the digital news publishers comes through Google search. And that is why the digital news publishers have become dependent upon Google to display their curated news. However, the issue that has started is related to the advertisement revenue here. Now, normally what happens is that the digital news publishers provide for advertisement options on their websites. However, issues have started over the revenues of such digital advertisements, which have been provided for by the digital news publishers. However, their revenue is also enjoyed by the Google. Now, this is primarily because Google enjoys dominance even in the digital ads business, and it is not just about hosting the digital news. Secondly, Google does not inform the digital news publishers about the amount of advertisement revenue that is earned. And finally, Google shares only a small part of the advertisement revenue with the digital news publishers. However, it has been argued that it is the digital news publishers which provide the quality and highly curated content on their websites. But it is the Google company which ends up getting maximum benefit in terms of highest advertisement revenue out of all the ads that are displayed on these websites. And that exactly has become an issue. In this regard, there's a global example where the Australian government has passed a law which requires the companies such as Google and Facebook to negotiate with the news outlets to pay for their content, and hence such a law has sought to level the playing field between the big tech platforms as well as the news publishers. So this is the overall issue where the digital news companies which host a variety of advertisements on their websites, the revenue of those ads is ending up in the hands of Google. And this exactly is the issue that has been raised at the Competition Commission of India by the Digital News Publishers Association. And already we have a global example where the Australian government has tried to create parity between the Google, Facebook and the digital news publishers by bringing out a law and making the field a level playing field between the big tech platforms and the news publishers. However, Indian government and the Competition Commission of India is yet to take any decision in this regard. So this is a news in transition. Just knowing what exactly is happening is important for us as of now. With this, we conclude today's discussion, and this is the question for the day.